BBC Audio presents a collection of captivating documentaries which paint a multifaceted portrait of Japan, from its famous historical figures to its diverse cultural landscape. In part one, we investigate the history of this unique country, exploring both its rich heritage and deep reverence for custom, ritual, and tradition. First up, in Japan in Five Lives, presenter Christopher Harding profiles five important historical figures. He begins with Daimatsu the demon Hirobumi, the women's volleyball coach at the 1964 Olympics. First broadcast on BBC Radio 3 on the 26th of July, 2021.
When I was a child, many a weekend morning used to begin with me sat in the lonely pre-dawn chill of our suburban living room, waiting for our big, boxy television set to warm up. Eventually, the thick grey glass would come alive with the image of a spaceship, shaped like a Celtic cross, rising majestically through a dark void, shot through with beams of moody celestial light. The Odyssey, as it was called, was commanded by a lightsaber-wielding hero named Ulysses. His mission? To seek out the kingdom of Hades, revive his cursed crew, and return everyone safely home to Earth. The most obvious Japanese contribution to this animation series, Ulysses 31, made in France and Japan, was a series of technical innovations borrowed from manga and anime, Japan's distinctive comic books and animated films. These included intense close-ups, rapid panning shots. Characters' personalities and relationships developed as much through pauses and glances as through cumbersome dialogue. But what really made Ulysses special was the coming together of ancient Greek and Japanese cosmologies, each attuned in its way to the role of fate and of forces natural and supernatural in shaping human life. The result was a thrilling sense not just of the grandeur, but also the strangeness of space. I was accustomed to Judeo-Christian talk of the cosmos as creation. That made it feel personal, purposeful, and in some deep sense as though it were there for us. Now, I found myself wondering whether I really belonged there, or rather, here. Were these feelings perhaps a faint late 20th century echo of the unease experienced by Westerners encountering Japan back in the mid-19th century? Some of them had bought into a thrusting European imperialism that dismissed talk of fate or supernatural forces as a mere cover story used by second-rate cultures blighted by laziness and inertia. They regretted the way that Japan's stunning natural landscape appeared to suffer from a kind of spiritual overcrowding. All manner of deities, demons, spirits and goblins jostling with one another and encouraging a sense of human powerlessness. Other Westerners developed a certain sympathy for Japanese understandings of belonging in the world, as more akin to shared tenancy than outright ownership. Our view of the world inevitably shapes our view of ourselves and our society, captured in two fundamental questions. Who am I? And who are we? As a historian, one of the most exhilarating things about Japanese answers to these questions, across the country's long history, is their relative freedom from the narrative arc provided by Christianity, of redemption, or its modern successor, progress. People across the centuries in Japan have managed to launch themselves into fresh and sometimes radical rethinks, seeing the past as a resource on which to draw, rather than as chapters in a story that they must continue faithfully to tell. One of the best ways to see all this at work is in people's lives. There's an expression in Japan, kuchibakari, all mouth. That powerful preference for example over rhetoric is going to be my guide in this series of the essay. I want to introduce you to five people who've pushed Japanese self-questioning onwards, helping to transform or regenerate a country sometimes rather unfairly stereotyped for its conservatism. We're going to work our way backwards in time, beginning with a great "who are we" moment that never was. Daimatsu Hirobumi, born in 1921, was part of a generation of Japanese who looked forward to seeing their country show itself off to the world and test its physical mettle at the Summer Olympics in 1940. They were due to take place in Tokyo, the first time that the Games had ever been held in Asia. But Japan's leadership in that era was not entirely wedded to the Olympics' peace-promoting ethos. By the late 1930s, parts of the mooted land route to carry the famous flame from Olympia to Tokyo ran through active war zones, many of them created by the Imperial Japanese Army. The Games were cancelled, and Daimatsu's generation ended up testing their mettle on battlefields and high seas across Asia and the Pacific. Drafted into the army in late 1931, Daimatsu served first in China and later as a platoon commander in Southeast Asia. After a campaign to seize India from the British went disastrously awry, his unit was driven back into the Burmese jungle, where he spent 5 months trying to survive by eating raw bamboo shoots. Weak enough to merit a stretcher, he refused one nonetheless. He'd seen other men lie down for a rest and not get up again. Who am I and who are we became, for Daimatsu, a matter of those who possessed the sheer will to stay alive versus those who did not, and who, as a result, never made it out of the jungle. Daimatsu did make it out, only to have his mettle tested afresh. After Japan's surrender in 1945, he was sent to a British prisoner of war camp in Rangoon, where he was made to scrub toilets and do the laundry of British female officers. It would have been hard to concoct, for a Japanese man of Daimatsu's generation, a more potent combination of humiliations than this. Failure and retreat, followed by starvation, national defeat, captivity, feces, laundry, and taking orders from women. Given the chance, later in life, to reflect in print on all this, Daimatsu characterized it as an odyssey of sorts. He returned to Japan as a man in search of as heroically vindicating a form of personal and national renewal as he could find. There were many others like him. That great question, "Who are we?" had generated some very dark answers in Japan across the 1930s and early 1940s. Daimatsu's conviction that willpower would see him through the war was bound up with a twisted enthusiasm in Japan and Nazi Germany for what superior races possessing a Nietzschean will to power might achieve in the world. Those achievements turned out to include slaughter, enslavement, torture, and the brutal incarceration of Allied prisoners of war. Amongst the first to reckon with all this and to seek renewal were Japan's school teachers. Guilt-stricken over their role in romanticizing war and helping to send hundreds of thousands of young Japanese out to kill and die, they emerged as one of the most staunchly left-wing and internationalist constituencies in Japanese politics. Scientists and engineers, meanwhile, sought to employ talents developed or deployed in the military in the service of peaceful rebuilding. From the futuristic bullet train to a transistor radio so small that its makers needed a short and punchy company name to fit on the casing. They chose Sony. Daimatsu's route to renewal ran through a cotton spinning factory in Kaizuka, near Osaka, run by the Nichibo Corporation. Like other big companies in Japan, Nichibo took an interest in sport, and with Japan's textile industry relying heavily on female labour, one of the sports it sponsored was women's volleyball. Daimatsu was appointed as coach of the Kaizuka volleyball team and began to put to innovative use his wartime experience as a platoon commander. As Daimatsu liked to put it, with winning bluntness, Damatte, ore nitsuite koi. Shut up and follow me.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.